Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good to be with you again on this first Sunday in Lent. I have to laud the apple I came in and let all four animals just like that. It was a sight to behold. We're going to engage in this worship service and the healing service about midway through our liturgy. And this is always a very special time for a pastor who conducts it, and I hope for you as congregants, because there are blessings in knowing that God is with us no matter how life turns. Please stand for the confession and the privilege. And one more thing, please remember Lent is here, and there are special worship services on Wednesday. Two services, so please make an appointment. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you and to all of us the entire forgiveness of all our sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing, A Mighty Fortress is our God, and Festive Word.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
After you, word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Repent and believe in the good news.
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. I begin the sermon in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Have you ever been in the wilderness? Have you been led there by a force like the one the Gospel writer calls the Spirit, as Jesus was? Alone, wild, animal, all alone, has that ever happened to you? It hasn't happened to me, I have to say that. But Jesus was driven by the Spirit into the wilderness. It was God's plan. That makes the word so interesting. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, and that, by any measure, is a long time. Previous to that, Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River by John, and there the heavens opened up, the Spirit of the Lord, like a dove, descended. A voice was heard, "You are my son, Jesus, my beloved, and I am well pleased with you." And then that 40-day experience in the wilderness took place. There he was tempted by Satan. There were wild beasts all around, but angels waited on him. May I say, we are in a wilderness now as a people. Everybody seems to be feeling it. You see the studies, one after another, of the impact of the times upon our lives. The wilderness of COVID, the wilderness of weather we have never experienced before, the wilderness of morality, what is right and what is wrong, the wilderness within the human family, black, brown, white. Will we ever get together and be what we are, family? The list goes on. The wilderness is not wanting to get along. The wilderness of religion, religion which should be a reconciling force in this world, but isn't. My religion, too many say, is the only right one. Our son Matthew has spent many hours in the wilderness. He was a dog musher for 17 years. He ran dogs in the wilderness of Canada and Minnesota and Wisconsin, many times all day long and many times all night long. And I have to say, the wilderness never fazed him. I kept asking, but he kept saying, "No, it's just fine." Parents know. Our kids don't tell us everything, especially when what they are doing is somewhat dangerous. Matthew tells us now of running dogs in the wilderness of Hudson Bay. And there the weather was so fierce, the ice particles blew in his face with terrific force, and they stung. And he says he saw at night, as he was on the trail, a strange phenomenon in the darkness. He was in the wilderness. Wilderness is an interesting idea in the Bible. Moses tended sheep in the wilderness. It's a biblical story we're following. He tended sheep in the wilderness because he was on the run. Think of it, Moses, God's leader, on the run. He was wanted for murder back in Egypt. He beat up an Egyptian guard to death because the guard was beating up a fellow Israelite. The wilderness was the refuge place for Moses. It was his hiding place. But God got to Moses even in the wilderness. There God blindsided Moses, you can say it that way. "Go back to Egypt," God said, "even with the sentence hanging over your head." And Moses made a wilderness decision to go back. A serious crime still hanging over his head. And there in the wilderness, he decided, "I need to go back to Egypt." underbrush and wild animals. Wilderness can be a place of confusion, too. Which way is north and which way is south? Wilderness can be a place of indecision. But for some, like Moses, it is a place where decisions are made. We can get lost in the wilderness, you and I. The stories of those who have been lost in the wilderness are long and lengthy and involved. But sometimes, the wilderness is a place where we find direction for our lives, where our faith is made strong. Many years ago, like some 40 plus years ago, a young son of the congregation we served in the San Fernando Valley of Los Angeles went on a hike one day, early in the morning, went into the wilderness. He got lost. He couldn't find his way out. The family gathered and they were worried sick. I spent the better part of the day with the family in their home waiting. Rescue personnel and police were called and they went to work and they worked hard. And they finally found him and they brought him home. And the joy was so great. I remember that so well. Today, that boy, no longer a boy, but a man, operates a rough water rafting company in Arizona. Did being lost in the wilderness shape what he finally wanted to do with his life? That would be an interesting discussion. In the wilderness, Jesus was tempted. And yes, Jesus can be tempted. It's not a sham act, it's real. And that's what happened to Jesus while he was in the wilderness. He knew what he was meant to do on this earth, but I think his wilderness experience firmed it all up for him. He knew his direction. And Jesus, we can say then, needed to be in the wilderness. And from time to time, you and I have to be in the wilderness too. It matters big time, what we make of the times when we are lost. And there are times when we are lost. And what do we do with those times? How do we think them through? And what do we do with them finally? We all have times when we need to think more deeply about faith and life, and how faith and life should come together for us. The Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness. God was sort of behind the whole thing. The Spirit understood that Jesus needed time alone in the wilderness to think about his role as Savior and Redeemer of a very real world. Too often, we don't see our religion that way. We believe in a religion that is way too unreal. We want to live in the never, never land of faith forever and ever. And that's not the way it goes. We want everything to be simple. We want things black and white and no in between. We want good and evil to be obvious. We want right and wrong to be clear, and we want our faith in the midst of all of that to give us peace. 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 But without warning, we can find ourselves in the wilderness. We can find ourselves in unemployed, and suddenly we're in the wilderness. We can find ourselves hearing a doctor's report that contains language we did not expect, and we are in the wilderness. A family member dies, a longtime friend dies, and we are in the wilderness. The life we once knew has so changed, we hardly know it anymore, and we are in the wilderness. What we once believed to be right and good is right and good no more. We're lost, and we are in the wilderness. Our lifelong religion, the religion you and I probably grew up with, starts to shake, and it does not seem quite as certain as it once did. We are in the wilderness. Things that used to mean so much now hold little meaning. And we find ourselves in the wilderness. It's been said the wilderness, or the desert, if you like, is a dangerous place. And no one goes there unless they have to. Jesus had to go there, and we have to go there too. It's a time for building faith and direction, even more. Jesus went into the wilderness. He was driven there, remember. The Spirit led him there. But I think, in my way of thinking about things, he chose to be there. He knew and he knows the wilderness is a fearful place, but he went there anyway, brave, stalwart, and faithful. He knows what's in the wilderness, and we should be wise enough to know what is there too. It's always a test. There are always wild beasts. Even Satan is there, ready to get at us. Jesus goes there anyway, and we go there too, and we are not afraid. Amen. Thank you. confess our holy Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. We speak that creed now. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into death. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. In Jesus, your realm has come near to us in every place and time. Give your church throughout the world a spirit of humility and repentance. Teach us to trust always in the good news of your salvation. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You have made a covenant of mercy with every living creature. Protect all the earth's creatures from destruction. Empower the work of biologists, conservationists, and science educators. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
All your paths are steadfast love and faithfulness. Direct the words and actions of leaders in our community and throughout the world, that they may maintain justice for the lowliest. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Even in the wilderness, you are with us. Walk alongside migrants and refugees crossing dangerous lands. Tend to those whose lives feel desolate. Give healing and strength to all who suffer. We especially pray for healing and comfort for those on our prayer list. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In the covenant of baptism, you claim us as beloved children. Nurture us in our baptismal identity and teach us to live within it for the sake of others. Strengthen this congregation's ministry of care and concern. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gracious God, guide the pastor to lead this ministry. Give us patience as we await your shepherd for us and provide the call committee the ability to discern who that shepherd will be. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In baptism, you join us to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We praise you for all those who have died trusting in your faithfulness. Bring us with them to the fullness of your reign. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. Please be seated. We are going to conduct what is known as a healing service. There are times in all our lives when we need the presence of God in our lives, and this service directs us to that end. So as I read, think through the things of your need, sicknesses that you are dealing with, and let us remember and receive the hand of mercy from our Lord. The ministry of Jesus invites us to new life in God and with each other. We proclaim the good news that God desires us to be healthy and one in the body of Christ. You are invited to offer yourself, whatever your sickness of spirit, mind, or body, and receive a sign of healing and wholeness in the name of the Triune God. If there is someone near you, or if you are watching and listening to this service in your home, find someone who would be willing to lay hands on your head or on your shoulders. Invite them to do so. You do the inviting. Otherwise, I invite you to place your hand over your heart and receive these healing words. In the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, may you be strengthened and filled with God's grace, that you may know the healing power of the Spirit. Amen. In remembrance of your baptism, I now invite you to make the sign of the cross on your forehead. Child of God, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Let us pray. God of mercy, source of all healing, we give you thanks for your gifts of strength and life, and especially for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the health and salvation of the world. Help us by your Holy Spirit to feel your power in our lives and to know your eternal love through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the God of all consolation bless you in every way and grant you hope all the days of your life. May God restore you to health and grant you salvation. May God fill your heart with peace and lead you to eternal life. Almighty God, bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and together we say, Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
The frogs chase all of us. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,